Good evening to you all. Let's welcome all of you for another fruitful PEMSA evening talk. It's my pleasure to introduce today's lecturer. He's Dr. Janaka Jayasinghe from 96-97 batch, and he was a brilliant academic as an undergraduate. Currently, he's working as the consultant obstetrician and gynecologist attached to Base Hospital, Mayangana. So Dr. Janaka will be discussing. He'll be discussing on infections in pregnancy. And you all can clarify or ask questions at the end of the lecture, right? Over to Dr. Janaka.
Thank you, Gyan. In fact, I am going to talk about infections in pregnancy. When we talk about infection, there are a number of microorganisms which cause disease in human body. I think you all have learned into depth organisms during your microbiology lectures and when you are doing medical appointment. Every organism which causes disease in humans can also infect the pregnant lady. But there are some infectious agents, microorganisms, which cause severe maternal and fetal morbidity and mortality, as well as the which infect the pregnancy, which are not seen out of pregnant patients. Therefore, we are going to discuss about those special situations. When we talk about, I am focusing on the on these lectures, when we talk about the infections in pregnancy, I broadly classify these infectious agents into three main parts. Some infectious agent, they cause severe maternal morbidity and mortality, which are not seen out of pregnancy. The common example is varicella zoster virus. Infections of varicella zoster virus to a pregnant lady in the latter half of pregnancy can cause severe maternal morbidity, such as severe pneumonia, respiratory distress, and as well as encephalitis and meningitis. There are some infectious agent which can complicate pregnancy, such as the common examples are urinary tract infection, bacterial vaginosis. They can precipitate labor, and the mother can go into preterm labors. Therefore, urinary tract infection, which is out of the gynecology and obstetric infectious agent, they can complicate the pregnancy. Therefore, I am going to focus on those things also. And especially, there are some infections that cause fetal complications. Access to the fetus by an infectious agent can be transplacental during delivery or after birth. Some infectious agents are teratogenic to the baby. More common example is rubella. Some infections are not teratogenic to the fetus, but they can cause severe fetal disease. For example, parvovirus B19. It is not teratogenic, but it can cause myocarditis, anemia, and heart failure. It can transmit to the baby, and baby can have HIV infection. Those are the common three type of infections that affect pregnancy. During my lecture, I am not much focusing on individual microorganisms. I am discussing some important clinical points, which are more clinical oriented lecture. First of all, we'll go into the third part, fetal complications that can cause the infectious agent that can cause fetal complications. Congenital infections. During my lecture, I'm trying to understand, make you understand the maternal and fetal test that can determine individual infection. And what are the long-term implications of fecal infection, and understand the treatment and preventive measures. The key point is majority of common maternal infections acquired during pregnancy are of little or no consequence to the baby. Fetal impact is gestational dependent. This is very important. Some infectious agents cause more harm to the baby during the first trimester. For example, rubella virus. If the mother gets infection during the first 8 weeks of pregnancy or first trimester, there is more serious damage to the baby. But if the rubella virus, if the mother gets rubella infection the latter half of pregnancy, the chances to baby affected is minimal. So vice versa, there are some infectious agents which cause more damage during the latter half of pregnancy. For example, varicella zoster virus, that can cause, usually varicella zoster virus can cause both sides, especially the POV19 virus is more transmitted to the baby during the latter half of pregnancy and more severe impact to the baby, causing severe high drops in the latter half of pregnancy. The fetal impact, mainly the teratogenic impact to the fetus, usually we know it is in the first half of pregnancy. I think when we elaborate it more further, intrauterine life broadly can be classified into three main parts. The first 3 weeks from the fertilization, which we call pre-embryonic period, and 3 weeks to 8 weeks of gestation, which we call embryonic period, and from 8 weeks to 38 weeks, which we call fetal period. The pre-embryonic period, there is proliferation from morula to blastocyst, and further proliferation take place. No organogenesis has occurred. Therefore, if there is an impact, teratogenic impact to the fetus, most of the cells are affected. Most of the parts of the fetus is affected. Therefore, it is said to be fetal loss. It means miscarriage. And if the teratogenic impact during the embryonic period, which is where the organogenesis takes place, the fetal teratogenic impact mainly affect the highly proliferating, highly proliferating organs such as heart, brain, and those things. Therefore, organogenesis is affected. Therefore, during these organs may be affected. They may be surviving up to 40 weeks, cell malformations. Then further, now fetal impact in the latter half of pregnancy, in the fetal periods, even the infection is there, the teratogenic impact is less. Therefore, it is important to find out in which gestation the infection is acquired by the mother and what is the placental transmission to the baby during that period. And the other thing is we need a prenatal diagnosis when there is an infection. The broadly the prenatal diagnosis, some for some infections we do routine screening. For example, to screen for syphilis we do DDRL test. To screen urinary infection, we do midstream urine sample for culture. And sometimes we do investigate with the history of exposure of the mother. For example, if there is a history of exposure of the mother for varicella zoster virus or rubella virus, then we screen the baby whether there is any fetal impact by doing ultrasound scan or other serological things. The other thing is, we want to investigate the mother if there are some fetal markers that indicate some infection. For example, when we are doing anomaly scan at the 18 to 22 weeks of gestation, if there is any problem, we detected hydrocephalus or microcephaly or any fetal anomaly, then we want to suspect whether there is any infection has undergone to the mother during the past few months. Therefore, we can do prenatal diagnosis of the mother during after if there are some fetal markers on the ultrasound scan. Those are the some basic things that we should keep in mind when we are studying congenital infections. Yes, congenital, when we are talking about congenital infections, infections of developing fetus or newborn that can occur in utero during delivery or after birth. The common infections that we call the synonym as TORCH, Toxoplasma gondii, and O stand for other agents such as Treponema pallidum, which cause syphilis, congenital syphilis, and varicella zoster virus, Pavo B19 virus, and HIV. Rubella, cytomegalovirus, herpes simplex virus. As I told you earlier, the transmission of to the baby can occur through the transplacental route or during the childbirth or during the breastfeeding period. Then we'll little bit focus into individual organisms. First, rubella. As we all know, rubella virus, commonly we call German measles, is found in human that is transmitted by aerosol route. Rubella is normally a mild disease, and especially we see in children, and usually mother acquire rubella after exposure to the infected child. Incubation period is 14 days, and the classic feature is the non-confluent maculopapular rash, as usually we see first in the face and spread into the trunks, and which is followed by lymphadenopathy. Usually we see in the occipital area or post-auricular area and cervical area prior to or after the lasting of the disappearing of the rash. The signs of often accompanied by the prodromal phase such as low-grade fever, headaches, sore throat and cough. In 20 to 50% of cases, the entire infection is subclinical. As more complications are arthralgia, arthritis, rarely the form infectious encephalopathy and thrombocytopenia can occur. The rubella viremia occurs 7 days prior to the rash developing and then 7 to 12 days after the onset of the rash. Hence, the person is infectious for over 2 weeks duration. Therefore, if a pregnant lady coming with a typical rash of rubella, you have to trace the contact trace via the history. If you are suspecting rubella infection, the diagnosis can be confirmed by doing the throat swab culture. But commonly we do is we get serology for rubella specific IgM immunoglobulin. And presence of rubella specific IgG indicate previous infection or immunization. And usually in our routine immunization process, all are given rubella vaccination, it gives a lifelong immunity. When we talk about the gestation, the most vulnerable gestation for transplacental infection is in the first trimester. Usually, if mother infected during the first trimester, the fetal impact is around 80%. Out of these, congenital defects occur about 85% of the population, 85% of the fetuses. And multiple defects are more common if the infection took place during the first 8 weeks of gestation. Usually, most of the infection that took place before 8 weeks, if the fetal impact is more, there is more chance of miscarriage. After 12 weeks, the risk to the fetus declined rapidly, but somewhere around 25% in the early second trimester. The common outcome is infection in the early trimester. The common outcome is congenital rubella syndrome. The classic abnormalities of the congenital rubella syndrome, as seen in the picture, it is heart defects. Most common are patent ductus arteriosus, pulmonary stenosis, pulmonary arterial hypoplasia, and they can have eye defects, commonly cataract, microphthalmos, and retinopathy. CNS problems are common, associated with mental, psychomotor delay, speech, or language delay. The microcephaly is a key feature, which can be detected during routine ultrasound scan, and they can have sensorineural deafness. Fetal infection later in the pregnancy may result usually the deafness, and there are emerging evidence to suggest that in utero exposure to the rubella infection have a long-term mental health sequelae in the babies after born. That it is said there is a high risk of schizophrenia they can have in adulthood. The rate of infection declines rapidly between 12 to 18 weeks of gestation and almost zero after 20 weeks. The diagnosis can be done by taking a blood sample from the fetus and checking it for specific IgM antibody. Or we can check rubella specific RNA via reverse transcriptase PCR. There is no proper treatment process, therefore the primary prevention is important. The primary prevention is done by childhood vaccination, because the vaccination causes 100% seroconversion rate. The vaccine is a live attenuated vaccine, therefore it is contraindicated in pregnancy. Usually we check pregnancy if we are giving a live attenuated rubella vaccine to the childbearing age woman. And after vaccination, we advise to avoid pregnancy for 1 month after that. Those are the key things in rubella congenital infection. Now we move into cytomegalovirus. It's a double stranded, as we all know, it's a double stranded DNA virus that belongs to herpes family. It's the one of the most common congenital infection, usually in the European countries, and the prevalence of congenital cytomegalovirus infection at birth is around 1%. It's more common in the Western population. The reported incidence of primary maternal infection in pregnancy is around 1 to 4%, and out of that, there is a 1/3 of fetal transmission. More than 2/3 of the pregnant woman usually is serological evidence. There are some serological evidence of previous infection. The key thing is, even though there are serological evidence of infection, they can have recurrent infection. From the recurrent infection also, there is a chance of fetal transmission, but the chance is very low. It is around 1 to 3%, but can have fetal infection. Cytomegalovirus, almost all cytomegalovirus infection in non-immunosuppressed pregnant women are asymptomatic. Usually they are asymptomatic. Only a proportion of the women can display a mononucleosis-like syndrome. But transmission of virus require close contact between individual to contaminated urine, saliva, semen, cervical secretion, or breast milk. Cytomegalovirus immunoglobulin, IgG, has a high sensitivity and specificity as a sign of a past or recent infection. This is an important point in diagnosing the cytomegalovirus infection. Therefore, seroconversion from two samples will provide the most accurate and reliable diagnosis of primary infection. We are not rely on the IgM for primary infection. Although CME, IgME suggestive of a recent or ongoing infection with high sensitivity, its specificity or low, specificity is low. Therefore, what usually do is, in UK practice, they keep a booking blood sample in each and every patient, and they compare the cytomegalovirus specific IgG titer with the booking blood and the indent sample. By that, they can diagnose whether this is a recent infection or previous infection. But there is HiFi techniques. If both IgE and IgM are present, there is a special technique called cytomegalovirus IgG avidity testing can be performed. This test will examine the binding capacity of cytomegalovirus IgG antibodies, which is low early after infection. When we go into clinical, the 80 to 90% of the neonates with congenital cytomegalovirus infection are asymptomatic in neonatal period. Usually, the cytomegalovirus, there are some ultrasound features that we can detect. The features can be IUGR, they can have microtephaly, they have cerebral atrophy, ventriculomegaly, intracranial calcification, and fetal hydrops. The likelihood of cytomegalovirus having an effect on the fetus is not gestational dependent. This is very important point. It is not the severity to the baby is not gestational dependent. If the infection occurred in the early trimester, there can be more brain affected. And if the infection occurs in the latter half of the pregnancy, it is more hepatitis and thrombocytopenia. Another thing is cytomegalovirus infection is the most common cause of deafness and learning disability in UK. Therefore, the impact to the newborn is very high from the cytomegalovirus infection. The outcome for the 10% of the neonates who are clinically affected at date of 30% and 90% will have severe neurological sequelae. Of those cases, long-term sequelae. The diagnosis of fetal infection may be suggested by maternal serology and ultrasound findings. The woman with fetal diagnosis, which is usually be a quantitative PCR on amniotic fluid. Sometimes we can check the cytomegalovirus specific PCR on possibly from the chorionic villi sampling or fetal blood sampling. The diagnostic sensitivity is high if the sample is taken after 21 weeks of gestation, because by that time fetal diuresis had established. Therefore, more cytomegalovirus RNA comes to the more cytomegalovirus genes comes into the amniotic fluid. And it is more sensitive if we do the test 6 weeks after the maternal serum is positive. There is, for the treatment wise, there is no particular vaccine, but there is an evolving vaccine. Cytomegalovirus glycoprotein B vaccine may potentially reduce the incidence of maternal and congenital cytomegalovirus infection with the suggested 50% vaccination efficacy rate. It is not in the practice yet. It's phase 3 trials. Will be coming soon. It is recommended that ganciclovir can transiently reduce viral shedding and may reduce the audiological problems of the infected infants. That's all about cytomegalovirus. Then we'll move into toxoplasmosis. Toxoplasmosis is a unicellular protozoan that is found worldwide. although it is more common in tropical areas. We all know it is the cat is the definitive host. Toxoplasmosis can be transmitted to the pregnant woman through ingestion of tissue cysts, which are found inadequately cooked meat or in uncooked food that have been in contact with contaminated meat. It can also be transmitted through inadvertent ingestion of cysts, oocytes, sporocytes in cat feces or contaminated surface water. Basically, it is unsafe eating habits. In adults, the infection is usually asymptomatic, although they may develop mild malaise, lethargy, and lymphadenopathy. Diagnosis of maternal infection is usually a serological one. When IgM and IgG are identified, conversion from the seronegative sample to taken at booking is helpful in accurately confirming the diagnosis. Likewise, as I told you, cytomegalovirus infection, this one also, we compare the sample, Indian sample with the booking sample. Without such a sample, interpretation is more difficult, as low level of IgM for toxoplasmosis can also be found in several. Toxoplasmosis can, when you go into clinical signs, congenital toxoplasmosis has a classic triad of symptoms which cause intracranial calcification, chorioretinitis, and hypocephalus. The likelihood of fetal infection and the severity are gestational dependent. In the first trimester, fetal infection will often result in miscarriage. If miscarriage does not occur, maternal infection is less likely to result in congenital infection. However, if it does, the differences are usually more severe. As pregnancy progresses, the likelihood of transplacental increase, transplacental passages increase, but the fetal injury less likely. On confirmation of the maternal infection, recommendation still for when we are going for curative site, still that spiromycin should be commenced to reduce the likelihood of fetal transmission. No sooner when we diagnose maternal toxoplasmosis, it is advisable to treat with spiromycin. Treatment need to be commenced within 4 weeks of infection. There is another treatment regime, combination therapy with pyrimethamine and sulfasiazine can be used. We are more focused on primary prevention. This requires prenatal education on the importance of food handling during pregnancy and cooking meat correctly, wearing gloves to handle cat litter, and avoiding contact with objects that are potentially contaminated with cat feces. Right. Then we'll just move into parvovirus 19, parvovirus B19. As I told you earlier, this is not a pathogenic virus, heterogenic organisms, but it can cause severe fetal disease. Parvovirus B19 also commonly referred, we know it's common. It's a single standard DNA, and at least 50% of the pregnant women are seropositive, and they are hence immune. The virus is often asymptomatic in adults, but they may initially present with that common cold, similar type of common cold, and usually the clinical feature is classic slap cheek appearance, rash, slap cheek rash. Adults who are symptomatic will often experience the polyarthropathy syndrome. The virus spread, we all know the virus spread via aerosol route, and those infected are contagious for 5 to 10 days prior to the rash developing. Diagnosis, mainly a serological diagnosis, which is triggered by a history of significant contact with infected party, usually a child, or due to a fetal finding. Or if we do, when we are doing an ultrasound scan, if we see some markers on the ultrasound scan, such as hydrocephalus, then we suspect POW-B19 virus infection, then we go for serological diagnosis. Positive serological diagnosis is made in the presence of POW-specific IgM antibodies, which is usually appear 2 to 3 days after an acute infection and may persist for up to 6 month duration. IgG antibody, after development of the IgG antibody, usually it is remain lifelong. Therefore, it confers a lifelong immunity. Usually the virus itself is not thought to be teratogenic, but effect on transmission to the fetus can be serious and fatal. Usually the transplacental infection increases with the gestation, 15% in fact to the baby up to 15 weeks of gestation, and it increases up to 25% thereafter, and at term it is around 70%. In early pregnancy, usually in the first and early second trimester, there is a 9% of fetal loss rate. After this gestation, the risk to the fetus is developing hydrops secondary to fetal anemia, cardiac dysfunction from acute myocarditis. Usually the this virus, POW-B19 virus, has predominant favor on the erythropoietic cells. It causes myocarditis. Therefore, they can have pancytopenia and they can have cardiac dysfunction. Then baby goes into heart failure. Then baby develop hydrops fetalis. Hydrops fetalis, by definition, you all know, they are the fluid inside the cavities. And there are subcutaneous edema. They can have hydrothorax. They can have pericarditis. And baby, and the fetus is swollen. There is about 3 to 10% risk of developing hydrops following infection. And 50% risk of fetal demise. The diagnosis is made either as a result of isolation of the virus from PCR at amniocentesis or fetal blood sampling performed as part of the investigation for fetal hydrops. Usually fetal hydrops occur 2 to 4 weeks after the acute fetal infection. If no signs of fetal infection, if there are no signs of hydrops infected, therefore the monitoring the fetus by ultrasound scan weekly for up to 8 weeks after maternal exposure should be done. Usually the fetal we do ultrasound scan to diagnose fetal anemia or fetal hydrops. Therefore, usually scan is aimed to middle cerebral artery Doppler or peak systolic velocity measurement. If there is no evidence of fetal impact after 8 weeks of maternal exposure, then we can stop screening process. 30% of the cases of hydrops will resolve spontaneously due to the self-limiting nature of this virus. When we are managing this hydrops baby, actually it should be done in a tertiary fetal medicine center. And the main problem here is fetal anemia. And we can confirm it taking a fetal blood sampling. We can take a fetal blood sample from the cord, which is called cordocentesis. Or we can take a blood sample from the intrahepatic umbilical vein. It is beneficial for the diagnosis of POW-B19 virus. On the same time, we can do intrauterine transfusion. As I told you, there is fetal anemia. Therefore, we cause intrauterine transfusion and we exchange the blood. And it is curative. That's all about POW-B19. We'll then move into syphilis. Syphilis, it's a spirochete which is called Treponema pallidum. Often infected with syphilis are not primary infection, is genital ulcer. Sometimes it may go unnoticed. Secondary syphilis, if untreated, they can proceed into secondary syphilis, present several weeks or 4 months later with cutaneous mucosal and sometimes systemic symptoms. At this stage, that syphilis is most contagious and it lasts for about a year. Finally, the infection enters a latent stage, which may have an absence of clinical manifestation, but can still result in transplacental fetal infection. It is very important. Even though there are no clinical signs, the fetal transmission is noticed. Worldwide, this is a common cause of fetal growth restriction and fetal hyperps notice. Screening of antenatal patients with syphilis is part of the national screening program. We all know we screen for syphilis. As I told you, it is VDRL test. The Treponema pallidum, for the diagnosis, it's not easily, we can't do culture, rapid, it's not rapid, we can't do it rapidly or cheaply. There are some several serological tests that are used, such as VDRL, RPR, fluorescent treponemal antibody absorption test, microheme agglutination assay, or TPI assay. There is spirochetes, bit large. They can cross the placenta, usually 14 weeks after 14 weeks of gestation. And with the risk of fetal impact increasing with gestational age. Transplacental transmission is greatest within the first year of untreated maternal syphilis. The results for an infected fetus are profound and range from spontaneous miscarriage and stillbirth through to non-minimum high growth restriction and preterm delivery. About 2/3 of newborns, infant with congenital syphilis, are asymptomatic at birth and are affected with deafness, neurological impairment, and bone deformities. There is treatment options. The use of penicillin has formed a long-stay treatment for syphilis, and the main important thing is this spirochetes, and there is not yet developed a resistance to the penicillin. Therefore, we can freely use penicillin, and the benefit is penicillin treatment will prevent the transplacental passage. However, as 14% of women, despite the recommended treatment, will have fetal death or develop neonatal with congenital syphilis. That's all about syphilis. Then we quickly move into varicella zoster virus. This is a DNA virus transmitted by respiratory droplets and by direct personal contact with the vesicular fluid. Primary infection characterized by fever, malaise, pleuritic vesicular rash. During pregnancy, the illness tends to be more severe, as I told you earlier, than in childhood, and it can result in maternal pneumonia, encephalitis, and myocarditis. Chickenpox in adulthood, although rare, can be associated with serious morbidity with the development of pneumonia, hepatitis, encephalitis, even mortality. The risks are increased in pregnancy with a 5 times higher mortality rate of 3 to 20%, and with pneumonia occurring 10% of pregnant women with the disease. It is the reason why we more focus on varicella zoster virus infection in pregnancy. As a result of this, it is recommended that a pregnant woman who present with chickenpox within the first 24 hours of a rash should be treated with acycloid. Over 90% of the antenatal population is seropositive for varicella zoster virus antibody, and hence primary infection in pregnancy is uncommon, because most of the adult population has exposed to this infection during their childhood. This is UK statistics. It's in the primary infection in pregnancy is around 3,000 pregnancies. At the booking visit, if an antenatal woman gives no past history of chickenpox, it is very important. She should be advised to avoid close contact with people with chickenpox or exposed people. The incubation period is 7 to 21 days, and a person is infectious 48 hours before the rash appear and continues to be infectious until the vesicle crusts over, typically for 5 days. This is very important point, because if a mother exposed to a suspected person, we want to calculate whether it is infectious. Then we can assess the maternal serology, or we can give immunoglobulin. Shingles, we all know, following primary infection, the virus remains dormant in the sensory nerve root ganglia and can become reactivated to give a vesicular erythematous rash in the dermatome distribution. The diagnosis itself is made from examination of the classic rash. Although treating seronegative women with significant contact with varicella zoster immunoglobulin, this is also very important. We can treat if the mother is exposed to varicella zoster virus infected person, we can give immunoglobulin. And if the mother is having active disease, we can give azithromycin. Actually, this treatment is to prevent maternal morbidity. There is no evidence to prove that it reduces the risk of the transmission to the varicella zoster virus to the fetus. It is mainly aimed at reduce the maternal morbidity. The effect of varicella zoster virus on the fetus is gestational dependent. In the first trimester, fetal infection may lead to spontaneous miscarriage. From as early as 3 weeks until 28 weeks of gestation, it is possible for the fetus to develop fetal varicella syndrome. Although the risk overall is small, 1 to 2% until 20 weeks, and most cases occurring after the first trimester and rapidly declining toward 28 weeks onward. And after 28 weeks, the chances low. The fetal varicella syndrome, they can have skin scarring, limb deformity, microcephalus or hydrocephaly, soft tissue calcification, and IUGR, the classical appearance. When managing varicella zoster virus, if it is suspected that a significant contact has occurred, then serology should be performed if the woman is not immunized to varicella zoster virus. This is the standard practice due to potentially serious effect on the virus in adulthood and relatively immunocompromised state in pregnancy. It is recommended that varicella zoster immunoglobulin, then if mother is not immunized, then we can give varicella zoster immunoglobulin. Administration is effective for 10 days after the contact of the mother. Repeat dose of varicella zoster immunoglobulin IgG may be given if further exposure occurs 3 weeks or more after the initial treatment. Women who have been treated with immunoglobulin should be considered infectious for up to 4 weeks of injection. Diagnosis of fetal infection can be made by ultrasound scan, as I told you, the classical features of fetal varicella syndrome. There is usually time lag, at least 5 weeks after the primary infection, before fetal differences can be seen. Further amniocentesis may be performed to confirm the diagnosis with PCR identification of the varicella zoster virus DNA. No treatment during the intrauterine life. For women known to be seronegative, varicella vaccine can be administered. Even though it is a live attenuated vaccine, we can give it in the pregnancy, and usually the pregnancy should be avoided 1 to 3 months after administration. That is all about varicella. And there are some important key points about the varicella. Hospital management with multidisciplinary team approach is obviously needed in case a woman develops any signs and symptoms of that may indicate serious complications. Especially Varicella zoster infection in the latter half of pregnancy after 20 weeks, there can be more respiratory problems of the mother. Therefore, it is better to admit the patient into the ward and manage. It is recommended that hospital referral should be made at the history of lung disease and as well as a history of lung disease, smoking, corticosteroid. If the infection occurred at the time of the delivery, then if possible, delivery should be delayed 7 days to allow for antibody transfer to mother to fetus. As the risk of neonatal varicella is significant, this is a condition associated with high morbidity and mortality. Therefore, if the infection took place at the latter half, at the time near the time of delivery, it is better to delay the delivery. However, treatment with acyclovir is recommended. No specific treatment is required if the woman develops shingles, as the fetus or neonate will protect by maternal antibodies because it is a secondary infection. Mother already has antibodies, therefore antibody then cross the fetus, therefore there is an immunity to the fetus. Postnatally, after delivery, if the woman develops chickenpox within 7 days of delivery, then there are no antibodies to the mother, baby. Therefore, baby should be treated with varicella zoster immunoglobulin. Those are the main key infectious agent that cause congenital anomalies or congenital infection of the baby. Now we'll move into infections in pregnancy, the other category. As I told you, there are some infections that have significant impact on women's health or requiring significantly different treatment in pregnancy. First of all, there is herpes simplex virus. All microbiology staff, we all know the viruses. There are two types of virus. The type 1 associated orofacial infections and encephalitis. Type 2 associated with genital infection, although there is a varying degree of overlap. Herpes simplex virus is transmitted through close physical contact and mucosal surface or abraded skin and during sexual intercourse. HSV type 1 commonly contracted in childhood, resulting in up to 90% of the adulthood population is having positive serology. HSV type 2 is generally contracted from adolescence with the onset of sexual activity. HSV remain latent in sensory neurons as the varicella zoster virus, in trigeminal nerve in type 1, sacral ganglia in type 2. Reactivation occur as a result of triggers. Primary genital herpes is usually, primary genital herpes is usually severe. We all know there is a lesion with erythema, progression into vesicles, and it develop ulcer, finishing with crusting. Those lesions mainly involve the vulva and can have in the cervix, usually last in a week. Ulceration can occur. If there are ulceration, it is associated with lymphadenopathy, fever, malaise, and urine retention as it involves the urethra. Recurrent episodes tend to be less severe. Diagnosis is made initially by history and classical rash. In case, if there is a suspicious of primary genital herpes, the pregnant woman can be referred to the genitourinary physician for confirmation. We can do it confirmed by PCR. When we are managing HSV infection, there are two things that we have to keep in mind. What is the gestation of the mother and whether it is a primary or secondary infection. All episodes of primary genital herpes should be managed jointly with genitourinary physician. When primary genital herpes occurs in the first or second trimester, treatment with acyclovir should be commenced without delay. This reduces the duration and severity of the symptoms and the duration of viral shedding. In the absence of disseminated disease, the usual recommended dose is 400 milligram of acyclovir 3 times a day for about 5 days duration. It's a known fact that the lesions, vulval lesions, are very painful. Therefore, symptomatic relief is very important. We can use simple analgesics like paracetamol, or we can give topical anesthetic agents such as lignocaine. Provided that the woman does not go on and deliver within the next 6 weeks, the vaginal delivery advocated, and woman can reassess that there are no association with congenital abnormalities. Because after the primary infection, if the delivery is more than 6 weeks of gestation, more than 6 weeks, then we can allow vaginal delivery. After treating the primary infection, then daily suppression of 400 milligram acyclovir 3 times per day should be started from 36 weeks to reduce the occurrence of HSV lesions and to prevent asymptomatic viral shedding. Because when the mother is delivering, if there are viral shedding, it can infect the laboring, infect the baby. If primary genital herpes is suspected in the third trimester, that is from 28 weeks, then there is an implication for the mode of delivery. It is advisable, elective cesarean section is recommended, especially if the lesion appears in the last 6 weeks of gestation, as the risk of neonatal transmission is then as high as 41%. If a woman is laboring and decides to continue for a normal vaginal delivery, then maybe some benefit if treating with IV acyclovir and avoiding invasive procedures. Usually the invasive procedures that we do during the intrapartum period is fetal scalp blood sampling, fetal scalp electrodes. They should be avoided, because if we are doing those things, there is a high chance of invasion to the viral infection to the baby. The maternal management of an episode in the third trimester is the same as the early gestation. We can give acyclovir therapy, but it should continue until delivery. Women presenting at any stage of gestation with recurrent episode, if it is not the primary, recurrent episode, are at low risk of neonatal infection. With the recurrent episode, at the time of delivery, the neonatal herpes, the chances of baby getting herpes is 0 to 3%. Hence, the mother can have normal vaginal delivery. Invasive procedures also is advisable. Recurrent episode, we have to still, even though recurrent episode, we should give suppression dose of acyclovir. Usual dose 400 milligram 3 times per day for the last 6 months of pregnancy. In both primary and secondary outbreak, it is reasonable to expedite delivery when there is an active lesion and pre-labor rupture of membranes. If there are active lesions in the vagina, and if the mother comes with ruptured membrane, then we should expedite the delivery to prevent neonatal transfer. If primary herpes, when there is rupture of membrane, is a preterm, pre-labor scenario, the decision for delivery or conservative management need to be discussed with multidisciplinary team involved in the microbiologist and the pediatrician. If a conservative approach is followed, then we should use IV acyclovir. In the case of secondary herpes, because the risk of transmission is low, then the risk of prematurity prior to 34 weeks probably outweigh the advantage of delivery. Because in the secondary infection, it is advisable to keep the baby till it becomes mature, at least 34 weeks. HSV co-infection with HIV. HIV co-infection should be treated in line with non-HIV positive patients if the primary genital herpes occur in the last trimester. However, there is some evidence to support a more aggressive approach for recurrent infection, as there is evidence that the transmission risk to the neonate is high. Therefore, it is suggested that suppression therapy be commenced from 32 weeks, not the 36 weeks, 32 weeks onward. Those are about herpes simplex virus, that it is more, it, those are more about HSV virus. Then we'll move into HIV. Infection with HIV occurs through sexual contacts. We all know contacts with infected blood. This is a HIV in pregnancy, and overall HIV is a big topic. I am summarizing the important key points, clinical important points when we are managing a pregnant lady with HIV infection. In pregnancy, one of the major concerns, both for women with pre-existing infection and for those with new diagnosis, is the risk of mother-to-child transmission, we call MTCP. The majority of management in pregnancy and delivery revolves around interventions to maintain the low MTCP rate. Prior to such management in UK, transmission occurred in around 25% of cases, but it is low now. Now it's around 0.57%. Despite HIV in screening being routinely offered, HIV screening is, this is also a routine screening process which occurs in the national screening process for pregnant ladies. Despite HIV screening being routinely offered to all pregnant women, a small proportion of women who are HIV positive will be missed, either because they decline screening or because they are seroconvert after pregnancy, after they become pregnant. The management of both the newly diagnosed and those with pre-existing disease need to be a part of the multidisciplinary team. The risk of MTCP with chorionuclei sampling, and to a lesser extent with amniocentesis. Therefore, if we are doing some investigation such as chorionuclei sampling or amniocentesis, we should consider there is a chance of mother-to-child transmission. Any invasive prenatal testing should be delayed until the viral load is less than 50 HIV RNA copies per milliliter. All women should obviously be offered their routine antenatal screening with the addition of screening for hepatitis C. All pregnant women should be treated with combination antiretroviral. These are the key features we should remember. All pregnant women should be treated with combination antiretroviral therapy by 24 weeks of pregnancy in order to limit MTCP, or prior to this if required for their own health. Those women who conceive on therapy should continue those therapy. The type of therapy should and combination should be guided by a specialist physician involved in managing HIV infection. There is increasing evidence that exposure to commonly used therapy even in the first trimester does not increase the risk of congenital malformation. The important point is the viral load. Viral load is then measured throughout pregnancy with frequency depending on initial viral load, at which combined antiretroviral therapy is commenced. The mode of delivery for women taking combined antiretroviral therapy should be determined at 36 weeks and be dependent on the viral load. The form for women with combined antiretroviral therapy with the viral load of less than 50 RNA copies per ml, a plan for vaginal delivery should be made. When the viral load is 400 or above, with the gestation of 36 weeks or more, then the delivery should be planned cesarean section. for viral load in between, the mode of delivery is unclear and should be guided by the active viral, actual viral load, the trend, additional obstetric factors, and leave of the mother. Women having a planned vaginal delivery, delivery should follow the same management as for non-pregnant HIV, non-HIV positive women. Hence there is now thought to be little or no risk of maternal child transmission. Invasive procedures such as blood sampling and the use of scalp electrode are no longer prohibited if the viral load is very low. In women having planned elective cesarean section, if the viral load is more than 1,000, treatment with IV sidovudine infusion should be commenced if they labor prior to the section. This should be used for those who present in labor with the unknown viral load. If the viral load is very high, if the mother is going for cesarean section, she should be given IV sidovudine. And if a mother is coming in labor with the unknown viral load, she should give IV sidovudine. In all cases of pre-labor spontaneous rupture of membranes after 34 weeks, delivery should be expedited. It will depend on the antibody and the viral load and use of cart. For pre-labor rupture of membranes before 34 weeks, the timing of delivery need to be discussed by case by case. After the use of intramuscular steroid and optimization of the viral load and should be decided after multidisciplinary, we have to overweigh the prematurity and the viral infection. All women, independent of treatment and viral load, should be advised not to breastfeed after delivery, and she should be offered lactation suppression therapy. That's the summary about HIV. Then we'll move into hepatitis B. Hepatitis B virus is an extremely infectious double-stranded DNA virus that has three major structural antigens. We all know surface antigen, co-antigen, and E antigen. The blood-borne virus is sexually transmitted. Where it can be transmitted vertically and by blood transfusion. Among pregnant women in the UK, estimated there is around 0.5%, rising up to 1% in inner cities. Acute infection is often asymptomatic or associated with non-specific signs such as nausea, fatigue, and vomiting. The IV drug users, there is 30% of chance of developing jaundice. Physical examination may reveal they can have hepatomegaly, splenomegaly, lymphadenopathy in 5% of cases. The virus can go on to cause acute or chronic hepatitis. The acute condition is usually self-limited, with only 1% of cases developing fulminant hepatitis. The diagnosis of the condition is made by the detection of hepatitis B surface antigen in maternal serum. The detection of hepatitis E antigen indicates active disease. And the disappearance of the hepatitis B surface antigen and the appearance of the surface antibody indicate disease resolution. And these antibodies will provide immunity. The resolution usually occurs within 3 months, although a small number of those infected will continue to have viral replication for much longer time. All pregnant women who are routinely offered screening hepatitis B, usually we offer hepatitis B surface antigen routinely screen. Those women who present for the first time in pregnancy or who have active disease should manage as a part of the multidisciplinary team. It is essential to ensure partner screening and testing for other STI if the hepatitis B is positive. The risk of vertical transmission depends upon the antigen status of the woman. there is a 95% of transmission rate in the presence of both hepatitis B surface antigen and hepatitis E surface antigen, compared with 2 to 15% if the hepatitis E surface E antigen is negative. 95% of cases of transmission occur at the time of delivery. Prevention of hepatitis B virus infection of the neonate is achieved by avoiding fecal invasive procedures during labor and administration of passive immunoglobulin in the first 24 hours to the neonate of highly infectious mother. As there is, because as I earlier told, there is a 95% of chance of transmission at the time of delivery. Hepatitis vaccination is given to those born of low infectivity mothers. Vaccination is given to the baby who has low infectivity mothers. When the baby has been immunized, there is no contraindication to breastfeeding. If the baby is immunized, the baby can have breastfeeding. That's a summary of the hepatitis B. Then we'll summarize hepatitis C. Hepatitis C virus is transmitted sexually and via contaminated blood. In the UK, the most commonly seen with, it is seen with IV drug users, and 80% chance of an IV drug user becoming hepatitis C positive, hepatitis C virus positive in the first year of drug use. The overall adult prevalence of chronic hepatitis C virus in Western Europe is 0.5 to 2%. Hepatitis C virus present with non-specific symptoms associated with raised transaminase levels. Diagnosis should be made by identification of the hepatitis C virus and RNA, as antibodies are not detected until the late the disease. Early identification is essential, as treatment with pegylated interferon and oral ribavirin can result in 50 to 80% of those infected clearing the virus. Without treatment, 80% of those infected will go to develop chronic infection. Currently, routine screening of all antenatal patients is not recommended. We don't do hepatitis C screening. However, it should be considered for high-risk groups. Especially high-risk groups are the IV drug users. Women with new diagnosis should be managed in conjunction with the hepatologist. The overall risk of maternal to child transmission is 5%. Likelihood of infection is linked to the presence of hepatitis C viral RNA with those pregnancies with the mother is while the mother is hepatitis C virus RNA negative, there is a little or no chance to maternal child transmission. Co-infection with HIV also increases the risk of transmission to the baby. That's all about hepatitis, and currently intrapartum management should be the same as for hepatitis B virus. There has been suggestions that elective cesarean section may prevent some maternal child transmission. However, the data are not conclusive. There is no evidence that avoiding breastfeeding reduces transmission. Currently, there is no neonatal immunoprophylaxis available for hepatitis C virus, isolated hepatitis C virus infection. One slide for about hepatitis E and hepatitis A virus. Hepatitis E requires a special mention, as pregnant women with acute infection have a risk of fulminant liver failure of 15%. It's the most important one. Hepatitis E in pregnancy, they can develop fulminant liver failure for up to 15% with a mortality rate of 5%, which is above the beyond, which is not seen outside pregnancy. The reason for this increased susceptibility is not clear. The virus is transmitted by the fecal route and usually produces a self-limiting illness. I'm talking about hepatitis A. The transmission route and self-limiting illness are similar to those seen in hepatitis A. However, hepatitis A does not result in chronic illness or fulminant liver failure, even in pregnancy. Those are the main viruses that are important that cause severe maternal morbidity or fetal morbidity during pregnancy. Then we'll move into some bacteria. gonorrhea. I think you may know more about gonorrhea from microbiology lectures. It's a gram-negative intracellular diplococci. We call Neisseria gonorrhoeae. Transmission is by direct inoculation for infected secretions from the mucous membrane to one another. In out of pregnancy, the infection can ascend through the genital tracts and cause uterine and tubal infection. It is more common in young population and associated with multiple sexual partners and presence of other STIs and IV drug users. Usually 30 to 60% of women are asymptomatic. Those with symptoms, they are usually having an increased or altered vaginal discharge. They can have low abdominal pain, bleeding during or after sexual intercourse and because of cervical infection. And they can have dysuria because of urethritis. Rarely, they can have disseminated infection. It is important, resulting in fever, arthritis, and arthritis. Mainly, it is common in pregnancy. The gonorrhea infection in pregnancy, they can have ascending infection and they can have disseminated infection in pregnancy. Diagnosis can be made by several methods. Culture continue to be offer a specific sensitive and cheap diagnosis test at genital site. It allows the confirmative identification of antimicrobial susceptibility testing, which is of increasing importance as antimicrobial resistance to Neisseria gonorrhoeae is more common. Acute gonorrhea in pregnancy has been associated with acute gonorrheal infection, has been associated with miscarriage, preterm labor, pre-labor rupture membrane, and SGA, small for gestational age babies. It is the reason why you want to learn about gonorrhea during this pregnancy. If an acute infection occurs at the time of delivery or in association with ruptured membrane, there is a 30 to 50% risk of neonatal transmission. Neonatal infection, because while if there are lesions, if there are infection to the mother while the baby is delivering, there is a chance of conjunctivitis to the baby. Neonatal infection present in the first few days of life as bacterial, as bilateral parole conjunctivitis. From treatment with antibiotic is required to prevent blindness. It's important impact to the neonates. They can go into blindness. Therefore, immediate treatment is mandatory. Pregnant women should be managed as per non-pregnant adult guideline in conjunction with the general physician. Management include screening for other STI and advise avoiding sexual intercourse until the treatment has been completed and confirmed by the repeat SOPs. It is also important that the women's partner has tested negative for the or be treated. If not, she may get infection again. Treatment is with 500 ceftriaxone intramuscularly as a single dose, with the 1 gram azithromycin orally as a single dose. That is all about gonorrhea. Then we'll move into listeria. Up to 10% of the people carry listeria, a gram-negative bacteria. It's usually in the intestinal tract. Likelihood of infection depends on the strain of pathogens and the person's susceptibility. Majority of people will be unaware of the infection. However, pregnant women are more vulnerable to the infection. Hence, advice to avoid foods with an increased risk of contamination, such as raw meat, unpasteurized milk, and raw, unwashed vegetables. Listeria species can cause a range of non-specific symptoms, including flu-like illness, fever, nausea, and vomiting. In those that experience complications can go on to develop septicemia and meningitis encephalitis. Listeria infection has been linked to in pregnancy, miscarriage, premature labor, and stillbirth. It is also classically linked with the presence of meconium in very premature infants. Diagnosis made by symptom triggers, culturing of the organism from blood, stool, cerebrospinal fluid, and serological testing. Treatment should be with penicillin as in non-pregnant women. Then the other important organism is chlamydia. Chlamydia trachomatis is the most common curable STI in Britain. approximately 5 to 10% of sexually active women undergo under the age of 24 years are infected with serotype B2K, responsible for oculogenital transmitted strains of the disease. Risk factors for infection include age under the 25 years, new sexual partner, more than one sexual partner in the past year of sexual partner, and lack of consistent use of condoms. Trachomatis infection is frequent. Trachomatic infection is frequently asymptomatic in both men as well as in women. And ongoing transmission in the community is sustained by this unrecognized infection. In response to the evidence of high and increasing rate of infection, the UK government introduced a national chlamydia screening program in their countries with recommendation that screening offered to all sexual active men below the age of 25 years and those over the 25 years of age with a new sexual partner. Screening performed on first catch urine sample by ligase action test. Symptomatic women may present with abnormal vaginal discharge. Main symptoms are abnormal vaginal discharge, dyspareunia, abdominal pain, and mainly the dysuria. And if left untreated, it can result in PID and perihepatitis. In pregnancy as well as these symptoms, they have been also been linked to premature labor. These symptoms can have in pregnancy also, and especially these mothers can go into premature labor, pre-labor rupture membranes, and low birth weight babies. When the infection occurs at the time of delivery, transmission to the neonate is possible. If untreated mothers, 35 to 50% will develop conjunctivitis, and 10 to 20% develop pneumonia. If mother is untreated and during the delivery, after delivery, neonate can have conjunctivitis and pneumonia. Treatment in pregnancy differs from the standard as tetracycline. The standard treatment, the drug we use is tetracycline, but it is contraindicated in pregnancy. Therefore, we use erythromycin 7-day course. If not tolerated, then amoxicillin is an alternative. In pregnancy, management should be as with gonorrhea in conjunction with genital physician. Right. Then we'll move into Trichomonas vaginalis. Trichomonas vaginalis is a vaginal infection most commonly seen in with co-infection with other STI. It is more common in smokers and women with decreased education level and increased sexual partners as well, chlamydia. Women typically present with an offensive for the copious yellowish green discharge. Other symptoms include dyspareunia and vulvovaginal soreness. In pregnancy, vaginal bleeding may also be associated. The diagnosis can be made by saline wet preparation, identifying motile flagellated trichomonas, culturing, immunofluorescence, and enzyme immunoassay techniques can be used. Management should be as per the non-pregnant women, including referral to the genitourinary physician, and the use of the drug of choice is metronidazole. Right. Those are the main infections that affect maternal mobility and motility, as well as impact to the fetal well-being. Now, that's an important thing. We'll move into urinary tract infection in pregnancy. Urinary tract infection is a common cause of maternal morbidity and a potential cause of perinatal morbidity and mortality via preterm labor. It's a cause of preterm labor, therefore the fetal impact is more. Urinary tract infection is more common in pregnancy because due to the physiological dilatation of the upper urinary tract. Because of hormonal change, progesterone can dilate this, relax the smooth muscles. Therefore, we may see the ureteric dilatation and distension of the bladder because of the bladder tone, muscle tone relaxed. Therefore, chances of them getting infections high. The incidence of ASIM, then there are three entities in urinary tract infection in pregnancy. The first entity is asymptomatic bacteriuria, and they can have acute cystitis and they can proceed into pyelonephritis. Asymptomatic bacteriuria in pregnancy range of 4 to 7%, and if left untreated, 40% will affect develop symptomatic UTI in pregnancy. Cystitis complicate 1% of pregnancies, and 1 to 2% of pregnant will develop into pyelonephritis. Women who have a history of previous UTIs are at increased risk of UTI in pregnancy. As with those with diabetic, if a woman has a UTI history in the non-pregnant state, there is a high chance of she getting a UTI during pregnancy. Therefore, we have to screen. As well as diabetic who has received steroid or immunosuppression with kidney and with the renal tract anomalies such as polycystic kidneys, who have nephropathy, congenital anomalies of the renal tract, and who have renal stone, those patients have a high chance of getting urinary tract infection during pregnancy. This is the summary. Incidence is 8%, asymptomatic bacteriuria, persistent colonization of the urinary tract by the significant number of bacteria in women without urinary symptoms. They don't have symptoms. The chances are 2 to 5%. This is important because this is why we should do midstream specimen for urine culture in the each and every pregnant woman to diagnose asymptomatic bacteriuria. Acute cystitis. Acute cystitis distinguished from asymptomatic bacteriuria by the presence of symptoms such as dysuria, urgency, frequency, nocturia, and hematuria, and they can have suprapubic discomfort in an afebrile with women with no evidence of systemic illness. It is around 5%, 1%. And they can have pyelonephritis, significant bacteriuria in the presence of systemic illness and symptoms such as plant and renal angle pain with high fever, rigors, nausea, and vomiting. It is 2% chance of they getting pyelonephritis, and it is more common seen in second and third trimester. The common organism is the Escherichia coli, E. coli, 80 to 90%, and the other main organisms are Proteus and Klebsiella. The three complications, the main thing is they can have preterm labor and delivery, and adverse fetal outcome, low birth weight, and increased perinatal mortality. Fetal risks include fetal growth restriction, stillbirth, perinatal morbidity, and as well as they can have mental retardation and developmental delay later in life. The maternal complications, because of recurrent urinary tract infection, they can have preeclampsia and they can have anemia. The ascending infection can cause chorioamnionitis, and especially after delivery, they can have postpartum endometritis. The diagnosis is made by midstream urine culture as part of the routine antenatal screening to diagnose asymptomatic bacteriuria. Typical clinical features are urinary frequency, dysuria, suprapubic pain for acute cystitis. We can diagnose by urine analysis, mainly the nitrates on urine analysis. Fever, loin pain, and abdominal pain, vomiting, rigors suggest pyelonephritis. A clinical diagnosis should always be confirmed with culture of an MSU sample. Bacteriuria. That this is important. Bacteriuria considered significant if there are more than 100,000 organisms per milliliter of urine. Urine culture resulting in a non-significant or mixed growth should be repeated on a fresh sample. A clinical diagnosis should always be confirmed with culture of an MSU sample. Bacteriuria is considered significant if there are more than 100,000 organisms per milliliter of urine. Urine culture resulting in non-significant or research to be repeated. Treatment for 3 days is sufficient for asymptomatic bacteriuria. Regular urine culture should be taken following treatment to ensure eradication of the organism. About 5% of the women will have recurrent bacteriuria during the pregnancy and will require second course of antibiotics. Amoxicillin, penicillin, cephalosporin are safe and appropriate antibiotic in pregnancy. It is important conoxaclav increase the risk of necrotizing enterocolitis in the neonates, therefore best to avoid in pregnancy. Nitrofurantoin is a good urinary antiseptic, but it should be avoided in the third trimester at post hemolytic anemia of the neonate. Trimethoprim is a good drug for urinary UTI. It should be avoided in the first trimester because of its action on antifolate action. If it is acute cystitis, 7 days course of antibiotics is recommended, and antibiotics should be continued for about 10 to 14 days for pyelonephritis. Ultrasound examination of the renal tract is indicated in those with pyelonephritis or who has two or more proven UTIs to exclude any renal pathology. It is to exclude hydronephrosis, congenital abnormalities, and renal calculi. Continuous prophylaxis should be considered, recommended only for those with two or more confirmed UTI, culture positive UTI, and either one of the above risk factors or those with renal transplant. There are treatment regimes. Oral antibiotics commonly used are cephalosporin or amoxicillin, nitrofurantoin, trimethoprim. IV antibiotic, cefuroxamine, amoxicillin, gentamicin. Asymptomatic bacteriuria usually for 3 to 7 days. You should always follow up urine culture to confirm clearance of the infection. Acute cystitis, usually it is better to continue 7 to 10 days, should follow a midstream culture. Especially in pyelonephritis, for up to 14 days, sometimes it may be more longer, but this special thing is she should be followed up with urine culture in frequent intervals until delivery, because there is chance of recurrence. If there is, as I told you, there are some indication for prophylaxis UTI or UTI, the drugs we use is cephalosporin, cephalexin 250 mg once daily, or amoxicillin 250 mg once daily. This is about UTI, because as it is important in pregnancy, we should have a good knowledge how to manage UTI in pregnancy. Then we'll quickly get to know about other organisms which are important in pregnancy. There are some organisms which cause preterm delivery, preterm labor. Bacterial vaginosis has been associated with increased risk of preterm labor in many observational studies. Another thing, group B streptococci, colonization has been linked with prematurity. And on the same time, preterm infant infected with GBS can have severe consequences. Preterm labor is associated with Chlamydia trachomatis, as I told you, Neisseria gonorrhea, and Trichomonas vaginalis. And special important microorganisms, not only pregnancy, after delivery, postpartum sepsis was most commonly secondary to the infection with group A streptococcus. Specific infection in the puparium are caused by the same organism that caused this infection at other times. However, in addition, one should consider the possibility of Lancefield group A streptococcal infection and the possibility of influenza, especially both of which are known to carry a significant mortality risk in pregnancy and the puparium. In the postpartum period, endometritis is a significant thing. Endometritis is usually polychromal infection associated with mixed aerobic and anaerobic flora. Therefore, those are important. Managing those infections are important. With the endometritis, they can have bacteremia, maybe present 10 to 25% of cases. The organisms that contribute to this condition include group A, group B, beta hemolytic streptococci, aerobic gram negative rods, Neisseria gonorrhoeae, and certain aerobic bacteria. That is the end of my talk. I think it's a vast area that we have talked about infections. I especially focus that which are important organisms to the pregnancy for which increase maternal morbidity, mortality, and which has an impact of the fetus as well as the pregnancy. Thank you. Over to you, Gihan.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Janaka. Now it's time for questions. Yeah, there are two questions in the chat box, Dr. Janaka.
Yes, first thing is in. Sir, does asymptomatic bacteriuria cause preterm delivery? Yes, asymptomatic bacteriuria also. One thing is they can proceed into acute cystitis, they can proceed into pyelonephritis. And asymptomatic bacteriuria per se can cause preterm delivery. It is the reason why we, as I told you, why we screen it via urine culture to detect asymptomatic bacteriuria. The other question, can varicella during third trimester neurological sequelae in the child? Neurological sequelae less likely, but as I told you, but they can have meningitis, neonatal meningitis, but less likely. So what is the impact of COVID-19 in pregnancy?
A broad question.
Actually, I thought of including COVID-19 and H1N1 infection during pregnancy. As I told you, you have to learn a bit about H1N1. It has an impact on pregnant women. And COVID, actually, it is not, still, we think it is not doing much to the pregnant ladies. There are there can be evolving problems, but so far we think there are no more serious effect to the pregnancy and newborn.
Can I add, no one has found any teratogenicity or any congenital infections or the entities like UGR or FGR, we don't know. There is no direct causation as far as we know at, for the moment.
Yes, with the time, we can see what's happening. Think that it is not causing any serious effect because now we are giving vaccine also. Therefore, maybe not. There can rubella in third trimester cause congenital heart disease? No, as I told in my included in my lecture, they less likely to has a teratogenic impact in the third trimester by rubella. Can varicella during third trimester cause neurological sequelae in child? Neurological sequelae in child third trimester. Can varicella during third trimester cause neurological sequelae in child?
It's the same question you answered already.
Hello. So how do we manage PID complicating pregnancy? Yes, this is an important question and this is an important area. As I told you that gonorrhea and those infection, a pelvic infection can ascend during pregnancy and they can cause metallic inflammatory disease, and it is a very serious condition. Therefore, PID complicating pregnancy, it's a more maternal morbidity and mortality. Therefore, we should admit QIV antibiotic in a multidisciplinary team approach via microbiologist and physician. It's a, when we are managing, in mode management, IV antibiotic and proper care. When HIV viral load in between us, if what we can do in delivery. It is a reason I think in my lecture I included that one, 50 to 400. It depends on the actual viral load. It is more toward 50 or it is more toward 400. And we should discuss with the mother and we should include it. The multidisciplinary team, and we should discuss it depend on the case by case. So if rubella vaccine given during initially in first trimester, what is the next management? If given, actually I also have a patient, pregnant lady in my hospital who has given rubella vaccine at the gestation of 8 weeks, and we can do nothing. We have to just observe. And for fetal infections. In the standard practice, we can assess, we can check whether there are antibodies, whether there are infection to the fetus, and if there is, they can go for termination. But in our setup, we just screen, we do good anomaly scan and check whether there is anomalies, but still we have to wait and see. So is macrocephaly or microcephaly more commonly caused by cytomegalovirus? I'll check on that. Did I tell it? I think it included in my lecture. I'll tell you it. Do we all allow normal vaginal view for mothers infected with HIV, even if the viral load is less? So do we allow normal vaginal delivery for mothers? Yes. Yes, in Sri Lanka, usually we have the less popular, the HIV infected population is low. Therefore, more trend toward cesarean section, but ideally speaking, we allow vaginal delivery if the viral load is less than 50.
Yes, they are single best answers. So yes, we can go for vaginal delivery.
Yes, we can go for vaginal delivery.
They are asking maybe a past question appeared in the paper from a single best or
group. Yes, if it is a question, definitely you should say we can have a vaginal delivery.
Any more question?
That question one asked about cytomegalovirus, whether it is more microcephaly. Any other questions?
if you want to ask, you can unmute yourself and ask questions or type. Any more questions? If not, we'll wind up the session and we'll call it a day.
Okay. Thank you, Gyan, for giving the opportunity, and thanks, PEMSA, for organizing this type of lectures in this critical situation. And once again, thanks you for inviting me to give this lecture. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Janakajaya Singh, on behalf of PEMSA, for your dedication and for sacrificing your valuable time to deliver a comprehensive lecture. And I think you covered almost all the things, the clinical aspect, as well as that now these people are much more concentrating on the theory stuff because they have the true false and SBS. This entity is mainly for theory, but there is definitely clinical application. I think it's a comprehensive lecture, infections in obstetrics, under, say, in one lecture. Thank you very much, Dr. Janaka.
Thank you.
Okay, we'll call it a day. Good night.